Good evening.
Good evening and welcome to another episode of Tea with Salesians. Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers. Let's lift up our teacups.
So guys, today, as we begin this episode of Tea with Salesians, we have the special group called as Springtide. All right. Now this is a group of youngsters, 5 youth from Baroda. And they have formed a kind of a band as such. And basically, this band is about youthfulness. And recently, they have started a YouTube channel and released their first gospel mashup. And the 5 youngsters are part of this Springtide. This band are Agnello, Francis, James, Joyce, and Karuna. Okay. So now they'll be performing for us. We welcome Springtide, all of you, to put up your gospel mashup before us. Springtide, over to you.
If you're gonna stand somewhere, why not here?
Nice.
If you've got some time, why not now?
City on our knees.
Let's give a big round of applause to Springtide. That was really amazing. Very good harmony. Look at the comments. You've got really good comments. Okay, and a lot of love. So congratulations to you all. God bless you.
Thank you.
I think we should. I think we should name you all amazing Springtides.
Great, great, lovely. Thank you so much. God bless. It was lovely hearing you. Okay.
Waiting to hear your second harmony.
Okay. When are you coming out with your next song? Great. Thank you so much. Over to Father Leon Cruz now to introduce our speaker for the day.
Okay, today the theme for today's Tea with Salesians is the political community. And the first speaker we have today is Father Christopher Valentino. He's a Salesian priest. He's the director of a media center called Tej Prasarni. He's the director of Green Line, and he holds many other responsibilities. Besides, he also teaches philosophy in a place called Divyadan in Nasik. So today he is going to speak to us about the political community with focus on power and morality. Father Christopher.
Thank you, Father Leon. It is my pleasure to be addressing this lovely young group. And Springtide, you all have really done a wonderful job of putting us into the mood of this entire evening's day. And Father Leon asked me to speak something about the political community, which is taken from this book, The Do-Cat, What to Do as Catholics or Christians in the World. And this is what I will be focusing on today. The Do-Cat, my dear friends, is basically a summary of the social teachings of the Church, which focuses on justice, human rights, and common good as the basic parameter to live our Christian lives. And it has its biblical roots in Micah 6:8, to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. And it is from there that we pick up these teachings and from Jesus's narration of what will happen at the end times when he asks, what did you do to the least of my brothers? What did you do for the least of my brothers? So within that context, there are many things which the Do-Cat invites us to do. And among these many things, as we have been speaking about the environment, about sustainability, etc., over these last few weeks or weekends, today we look at the political order or the political community. Now this is mentioned in point number 8. Of the Do-Cat. It is titled Power and Morality, the Political Community. And there are about 23 questions which are answered in this book. That is from numbers 195 to 228. And this entire thing is divided into three subheadings. One is the political animal, human being as a political animal. The second is great servants. And third, the church and the state, the relationship between the church and the state. So let us go straight away to what the first subtopic speaks about. The first subtopic calls man as a political animal. Man is a socio-political animal. He belongs to a community. He belongs to a group of people, and we relate to one another and we live in relationship. We live in relationship to God. We live in relationship with our own self, and we live in relationship with our fellow human beings. And as such, any community, any relationship is based on certain values, on certain principles. And this is what the Church invites us to look at in this very important and crucial section of social action. It says that human societies have always developed from the early times some type of political structure for regulating and coordinating their own activities, their common activities. Now, this is not somehow linked to one type of political order, but it is something that the Church has worked with over the centuries. Over all these centuries, through monarchies, through emperors, through kings, through rulers, through various political orders, the Church has insisted that the law is sovereign and it cannot be based on the individual will of one single person alone. So that is what the Church is inviting us to look at from the perspective of this entire political order. And that is why it is titled Politics and Morality. This is a little bit of a problem here with my phone. Okay, we are back on track. And that is what the church is inviting us to do. And so the human being is inherently social. We relate with each other. We are responsible to build and develop relationships. How do we do this in our own way? So it quotes various people. It quotes Aristotle, who says that every human being is a political animal. Every human being has the need to order public life and to be able to govern and sustain it in order for the benefit of individual and of society as a whole. So when you look back at what the church invites us to do, it is very simple. It says, as Christ invited us, to give to God what is God and to give to Caesar what is Caesar's. You take it in our present political context, and we are asked to look at doing the right thing, to doing what is necessary, doing what is needed. And that is what we look at in the first section, in the political animal. The second section speaks about great servants. When you look at the world, we realize that there have been leaders, there have been rulers who have been enlightened, who are illumined by the natural law of God. And these people have tried in some way to make society better. And these are people who are servants. And this is exemplified in the life of Christ. And as is exemplified in the life of Christ, every Christian or every Catholic who follows Christ, like all of us, we are invited to look at the social order and ask ourselves, what type of service can we render to our brothers and sisters in need, especially in the socio-political context of our time? And that is what the church again invites us to. It says, look at the cross. Does the cross make sense to us? Do sufferings and difficulties and obstacles put us off? Or are we ready to take up the challenge and to contribute our might to the betterment of society and for our own selves? This is a very, very clear and classic case of asking whether I am at the service of my brothers and sisters, or am I looking to somehow fulfill my own gain? So that is how the church invites us to look at servant leadership. And that is why the Holy Father, since the 6th century, the popes have used this title, the servant of the servants of God. It is to be an example to political and social leaders all over that they are servants for the common good, for the public good. And that is one of the critical aspects of the entire social teaching of the church. And again, as you will notice, it is all based on the scriptures. It is all based on the scriptures. And that is from where we get our mandate. The third subsection is very simply looking at the church and the state, the relationship between the church and the state. There are many who say that religion and politics should not interfere. There are many who say that, you know, religion is good, it should be confined to your own homes, but it shouldn't be within the public sphere. So now in this context, what does it mean as a political animal, as a social animal, as a being who wants to relate with others? What does it mean for a Christian, for a follower of Christ? The church invites us to look at the relationship between the church and the state as something that is necessary for our own lives, for our existence, for the betterment of society, and for the upholding of rights, for the upholding of justice, and to arrive at the common good, something that is good for the entire society. This is one of the central themes of the entire Christian political ethics, if you may call it, and that is what we are looking at. So now within this ambit of, you know, the political situation of being committed to Christ and of following Christ in the socio-political sphere, all of us as a church, beginning from the Pope right to the least of the Catholic community, we are invited to be Christ in the public sphere. And when we say we are invited to be Christ in the public sphere, the main question not to be what did Christ do and what do we do as the church? So it is an authentic Christian way, not just to guarantee the protection of rights, but to demonstrate that we can boldly live a life of faith without opposition to serving the public good, or to arriving at what is right and what is necessary for the betterment of human society. My dear friends, this may seem very dense, and this book also is very dense in a certain way, but the Ducat is a great simplification of all the social encyclicals of the church. It just puts together in question and answer form what is the importance of Christian social living and how to live it. So, when we look at this entire thing in perspective, the content that you find for the political or the relational aspect of the church is very simply a call to a radical following of Christ with compassion, with respect, engaging and promoting the dignity of the human person, come what may. And that is where each of us are invited to live by conscience, by conscientious participation, promotion, and lifestyle of witness, witnessing to what Christ wants of us. And this is precisely what the church is proposing in this 23 questions. Okay? And that is what we are asked to look up. So now the question arises, how do we participate? How do we promote? How do we actively involve ourselves in this? That, my dear friends, is left to us, to our creativity, to our sense of urgency, how we can actually be leaven, be yeast, be salt, be light. That is what the church is proposing. And that is what Pope Francis is calling to be the walking, talking social doctrine of the church, with enthusiasm, with creativity, and with joy that can come from the following of Christ. My dear friends who are here, you young people, all of you put together have a great task, a great challenge. It is a responsibility, it's an accountability, and sometimes we who are pastors, who are clergy, who are, you know, religious, who are committed to the following of Christ, I should confess that we have fallen short in bringing this doctrine of the church to you, to others in society. And this opportunity, as Father Leon today, and this as part of this whole Tea with Salesians, has proposed this topic, it's a very good way to rejuvenate ourselves to be leaven in the East. Thank you.
Thank you, Father Christopher. Yeah, you summarized the Ducat very nicely for us. Next, we have with us Eileen Marcus. So she is currently an advocate at Bombay High Court. She's also the lawyer on the panel of the District Legal Services Authority in Mumbai. And she is also a recipient of many awards, like some Rex Karamveer Chakra. Okay, it's a medal for proactive voluntary citizen action to lead the change. She is recipient of the prestigious Legal Support Award by Humanity First Foundation and many other awards. More than that, she has worked a lot. When I read her profile, okay, she has brought about a lot of change even in our society through various PILs that she has supported or worked for. And with a lot of experience, she comes to us today. So we have Eileen, who is going to speak to us about her own personal experiences in this area.
Thank you, Father, for having invited me to share about my personal experience. Friends, today as we talk about making a change or being change makers, I've just worked on a very small presentation to convey my message to all of you so that we can together be change makers. So, Father, if I can share my screen.
Yeah, I have given the permission.
So, is my screen visible?
Yes. Yes, it's visible.
So, I have worked around my experience around these three words, okay? It is ACT. Now, as a lawyer, I began my activism right when I was a student at St. Xavier's College, and I must thank Reverend Father Rui Comello, who initiated the process of getting me admitted into St. Xavier's College, because it was known as a college where children smoke, and my parents did not want me to travel all the way there, thinking it would be a bad experience or a bad influence. But because of the trust that they had in me, I've been able to be a change maker with the initial experiences that I have experienced over a period of time. So, to take you to the first aspect of ACT, awaken. Today, we are trying to be awakened individuals. And one quote that caught my attention right from the time I was 16 years was, a ship is never safe. You know, the ship is not built for the shore, though it is safe at the shore. The ship is built for other purposes, to go in the water. And having socially conscious parents, I was fortunate to understand that there was a lot of inequality in society. However, gender-based violence or gender-based discrimination is something that I realized when I was traveling by train for the first time from Mumbai to five states. And there, because I was a girl, the co-passengers did not want me to continue my journey. And that is where this whole process of being awakened to the reality of society, that, okay, I am a girl, and so this is how society looks at me, and these are the expectations that society has from me. So how do I go ahead and try to bring about a change? So the first awakening happened at that point. C, challenge. During my activism, there have been several occasions when I have challenged myself. And I believe as a Christian, as a Catholic, as a follower of God, it is very important to understand that the Spirit is there not to see us timid, but someone who is giving us love, who teaches us self-discipline and power. So when I worked with a lot of organizations, I was working in the field of anti-human trafficking, where would we go to brothels to conduct raids and get children out. And there are a lot of experiences where I have seen children with cigarette marks on their body, blade marks, cut. There has been a threat to life throughout this experience. However, one thing that continued to hold me strong was the faith that yes, there is a change that is required. A lot of people, you know, generally tend to say that this is stereotypes. This is how we are. So as Christians, we have to forgive. And even if we see there is injustice around us, it is fine. Let us be quiet. But I believe that the Spirit has awakened me to bring about certain challenges. So one is, how do we portray women? How do we look at senior citizens? How do we work with the LGBTQI community? Can we be more inclusive in our approach? These are some things that you know, I have actually tried to work about. The second aspect that I would talk about is media. As a young girl, I was a lot influenced by media. And even today, we see, we read, and we believe. But by working on the field with the grassroots, I've realized that there is a lot of unlearning that I have to do. And this unlearning has helped me in my work with women, senior citizens. A simple aspect about, you know, integrity. So if I walk to, say, Dadar station and I don't see a TC around, maybe initially I wouldn't buy a ticket because kyun are TC nahi hai, kaun pakdega. But today that inbuilt integrity, or that integrity which has come with consciousness, that as a citizen I have my rights and I also have my duties. And it is my duty to have a valid ticket irrespective of whether somebody checks me or no. And these are concepts that, you know, I've been trying to take to youth. So now that I have quite a few youth with me, I would tell you, please educate yourself about the laws that are there. One example I would give you, when I had a surgery, and after surgery, I went to a garden and I was there with my husband. Since I did not wear Mangalsutra, there was no sign of marriage. The cops told us, you know, vacate the, or get out of the garden because it is closing time. It was just 6:30 and the garden was to be open till 8. And they said, go out of the garden. It is 6:30 and it is getting dark. So I told him, no, we've just come in at 6. We've paid for 2 hours. So let us stay here. And the cop started arguing with us. And then he said, chalo, police station leke jayenge. Aajkal ke ladke ladki unko kuch samajhta nahi hai. Today, you know, boys and girls, they just want to roam without telling their parents, and I'll take you to the police station. Because I was a student of, because I was a lawyer, yeah, by then, I was like, theek hai, chalo, lekar chalo. And when I confronted him, because I knew I was right, he did not take me to the police station. But had he taken me to the police station, what would happen? It would just be a discovery for him that we are married, and we are not loafing around, but we are there rightfully. So very often conviction comes from knowledge or from our understanding of how we look at things. Be a trendsetter. I have tried to be a trendsetter in my own ways, and I'm very happy to see Marina as a part of the participant. Because as an ICAFER, there have been many children or many youth that we worked with, and it took a little nudge or a little initiative to get a lot of people involved in this activity. So to give you an example, during the COVID lockdown, one thing that we saw was everyone was locked at home, but there was a need for people to pack food items. There was a need to pack ration. There was a need, and that is where a lot of youth got involved. And we started being trendsetters. So looking at justice, there is something wrong happening. There is a pothole which is not filled. I file an RTI. There is a school. Around the school, I see children smoking. I go write a letter to the ward officer that this is a problem there. So we need to look at problems and try to work around solutions to those problems. So politically, there is a lot of chaos. We all know about it. But it is very important for us to understand that we cannot change the system. We can only make small changes or make small efforts. So as youth, the first step that I would invite all of you to take is to get active in the political scenario, have some basic legal understanding, go visit your local police station, go have a walk, go walk into the court, just go and see the systems around you so that you are not scared. And whenever you have to raise your voice, you know the consequences, and then you can be trendsetters in your own way. Along my journey, I have seen that every time I didn't have to shout. There were some times I just had to be quiet, or I just had to exhibit courage. So once when I had to go to a police station at 2 o'clock at night as a lawyer, a new lawyer at that point in time, when a woman, a lady of 84 years was thrown out by her own children. That is when the courage, you know, that I can travel at this point in time. And though society says it is wrong or it is scary, but I have the courage and conviction in me that what I am doing is right. It is to bring justice to somebody. And so I can go about it. So these are a few incidents that I would want to share. The journey has not been pleasant. There have been people along the way who hate you, who do not like you, because you do not succumb to majority views. You are a minority in your own way when you try to be someone who's loving and someone who takes, you know, the step in the direction of justice. So it's fine. People will hate you. But as long as you believe that you have a value system that is promoted, a value system that talks about love, you will be able to make a change. And it is not important that everyone should love you to be a change maker. But somewhere down the line, the seed that you sow will surely bear fruit. And I want to conclude with the privileges that I had, maybe the freedom that I got from my family, the love that I got along the way from fellow activists, from my college and all. All of that have been a lot of opportunities that have helped me. And as a student of 19 years, I traveled 19 states in India alone in an effort to bring about a change, in an effort to see whether the Mumbai that I live in is a reality for other states. And that is where I encountered social injustice. And today as a lawyer, my mission is to eradicate social injustice and to make this world a better place. So thank you, Father Leon, for this opportunity.
Yeah. Eileen, thank you very much. Thank you very much for sharing your experiences. And definitely we remember the experiences a lot. And I'm sure some youth have been inspired by your talk. Now we'll have our group discussions. So as usual, in your WhatsApp, you would have received a new link. So click the new link and get into your groups, and let's have a fruitful group discussion.